Hey, good morning, everybody. Pastor Tony here. Resurrection Sunday, celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I'm glad you're visiting with us today. We always have announcements first thing in a video, and I just want to go over a few things with you. Up front in our narthex area, we have a welcome desk. There's all kinds of signups going on up there. We have the new members class. If you'd like to find out more about our church or you're a new member, you can go sign up for that. We also have sign up for our choir. We'll be starting a choir to help sing along with our praise team up there. And we also have a senior adult trip in October. They're going up north to Amish country to go up there and watch the story of Ruth acted out. We also have the women's paint class. That'll be on April the 18th. I think there's still some room for that. Also, the senior game night and pizza night will be there. Our senior adults will be doing something in April as well. We're also looking for some teachers to help out in our Joy Zone with our Real Joy Kids. And so we'd love to have you be a part of that. If you're interested and feel God leading you to teach our children, we'd love to have you be a part of our Real Joy team. Also, this coming Thursday, it's a skating party at the Cavalier Skating Park at, from 5:30 to 8 o'clock. Whether you skate, your grandkids skate, your children skate, come on out, have a good time of fellowship. There'll be hot dogs and snacks there for the children and you. It's a good time of fellowship. Maybe you're like me, just kind of enjoy watching people fall. You know what I mean? All right, some upcoming dates. This coming Saturday at Golden Corral, our women will be meeting for our prayer breakfast at 9 o'clock. So that'll be at Golden Corral. Also, Saturday's a busy day. We have the bundle of joy. We have the bundle of joy for the new babies coming. Another baby coming. We're celebrating, I think that's Brian and Daphne this time. And then also Saturday, the motorcycle ministry, our faith riders will be meeting and they'll be having planning out this coming season. So if you're interested and you have a motorcycle or you just like to be involved, just see Tammy and Pat Riley. The women will be having a game night on April the 12th. And so women, they're active here at the church. They're always doing something and they're doing fantastic things for the Lord. Mommy and Me, that meets the third Friday, I believe, in April. Mommy and Me, they meet here at the church. The mothers bring their child in and they have a Bible study and a lesson and a craft for the children. And it's just a good time for all the moms to be there and just celebrate and have a good time connecting with other moms within the church. And then the last thing, it's the third Saturday of every month, is the men's breakfast at Golden Corral. We seem to be going to the trough a lot, you know what I'm saying? Hey, today's going to be a fantastic day. It already has been. It's a resurrection day of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. If you're visiting with us, I'd love to spend some time with you afterwards. We have a blessing bag we'd like to give you. And I know there's going to be more information at the end of the service for the Easter egg hunt. I heard we have over 3,200 eggs. That's the Real Joy people stepping up. So every child is going to get about the same amount. And we're going to make sure of it. Okay. So listen to the instructions and where to go for your child's age. So let's get ready to worship and praise and worship our Lord, right? Have fun worshiping the Lord. Love you all.
Good morning. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Let's all stand. We've been made more than conquerors through the blood of Jesus. Amen. Sing, church.
Seated above, enthroned in the Father's love, and destined to die, poured out for all mankind. God's only Son, perfect and spotless one. And He never sinned, but suffered as if He did. Yeah.
Is alive. We celebrate today. Jesus is alive. He owns the cattle on a thousand hills, but yet he can come in and live within your heart. Today is one of those days that a lot of people come to church that don't normally go to church, and we're glad you're here. What we want to do is I want to tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way when there ain't no way. He rises up from an empty grave, and there ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Come on, Dad.
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? Let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? Cause shame's done all it's stealing. Are you desperate for some healing? Let me tell you about my Jesus. He makes a way when there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you.
We're singing about, let me hear you say amen. How about a little wave and praise him this morning? Let's sing the chorus again, Daphne. Amen, amen, amen. Worship Jesus today. Woo! Come on, church, sing.
He makes a way when there ain't no way. Rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and grace is free, and the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen.
Celebrating Jesus is alive. Amen. We love you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Jesus is in the house today. Listen, we've come together on Easter Sunday to celebrate the resurrection. Amen. And today, being Easter Sunday, it's a glorious day. Amen. It's a glorious day. We've been set free because the stone has been rolled away. The tomb is empty, and Jesus is alive. Jesus is alive. One day, we'll join him on the most glorious day ever. And we will live in the presence of God forever and forever and forever. One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glory. Oh, glorious day. Somebody say amen. Oh, one day they led him up Calvary's mountain. One day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering, anguish, despised and rejected. Bearing my sin, my Redeemer is he. The hand that healed nations stretched out on a tree. He took the nails for me. Living he loved me. Dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sin far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day.
One day the grave could conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door.
Death cannot hold him, the grave cannot keep him from rising again. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glory. Trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glory will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me. Dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, One day, the skies will split wide open. The dead in Christ shall rise first. And those that are alive and remain will join him in the air. What a glorious day. Go back to the trumpets. One day the trumpet sings, church.
One day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glory will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine. Living he loved me. Dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified. Freely forever. One day he's coming. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious day. Oh, glorious
day. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise him with your hands. Good job, girls. Good job, good job. Didn't our kids do a great job? Amen, amen. You can be seated. Jesus is in the house today. Celebrating the risen Savior. The world will try to confuse you. The world will try to change you away from what God has planned for you. Keep looking to Jesus, church. If we can have some ushers come forward, we'll continue to worship in our giving. If you're visiting today, I hope you got a visitor's packet. If you filled out your visitor's card, you can just drop that into the offering plate. We'd love to get to know you better. There'll be an opportunity at the end of the service for us to sit down and talk with you a little bit. I say all the time that we're mostly normal people. We're all in different shapes and different sizes and different ages, but you are welcome here. We love Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We have sang to you. We have sang for you. We have played the instruments, and the congregation has made a joyful noise unto you today. You are the first, you are the last, you are the beginning, and you are the end. And we worship you today. Lord, as we pass the offering plates in and out of the aisles, Lord, bless those that give. And Lord, bless the tithes and offerings and Operation Joy commitments. Take them, multiply them, and use them for the upbuilding of your kingdom, Jesus. We love you. We love you. We love you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. congregation. Thank you, praise team. Awesome job. Good job, good job, good job. We've got a special, the Sign Our team's going to come out, and they're going to get ready to minister to us. Charlie, you might peck on the door there. They may be locked in. Yes, we are ready. So just let me ask a question real quick when they're coming. How many of you all came to Sunrise service this morning? That's awesome. We had like 200 people here for Sunrise service, and it was just awesome to be here together. Amen. Ladies, are you ready? Okay.
A place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever like a flood comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, a place where sin and shame are powerless, where my heart has peace with God and forgiveness, where all the love comes like a flood.
Great job. Great job. Great job. So we're here celebrating the resurrection and that Jesus is alive. But I think sometimes we say it too easy. The suffering that Jesus encountered willfully to carry the sin of all mankind, past, present, and forward. But you know what? The death of Jesus and the resurrection has made all things new again. Become me. This is not.
not the end. I am all things new again.
It is finished. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you so. But I go and prepare a place for you, so that where I am, there you may be also. Jesus is alive. You say, how much does Jesus love you? He loves you this much. That's how much. Come on, Pastor, I'll get the podium. If you can get the stool, is that okay?
Yep.
Okay.
We'll dismiss our
children. You can be dismissed to the joy zone. Good job, kiddos.
Go ahead and grab that pulpit, Mark.
Yes. All of our kids, we love them.
Need to pray for our children's workers today. They are wound up this morning. I got to tell you, I sat over here today like I normally do, and I had three or four children over there. Girls that were waiting to come up here, and man, they were singing praises to the Lord. That was just amazing, and I was blessed just to hear them sing. And I love our children's department and what they're doing over there. All right. Let's open up in prayer. We'll jump into this. Can we do that? Yeah. Chris Scott over there and them kids, he's going, they ain't that bad. Let's pray. Father God, I come to you right now. Thanks so much for the power of prayer. Father, I thank you so much that it is finished, that Jesus paid the ultimate sacrifice. Father, I thank you for our children's ministry, for sign art, for just being able to sing praises to you. Father, I can't imagine what it's going to be like when I'm standing in your presence singing praises to an audience of one. It's all about you. Father, I thank you for our children's ministry and for them singing out and just not being afraid to worship God. God, today we know that it's a special day. We are celebrating the risen Savior. And God, I ask that you speak to our hearts, speak to our minds. It's not by accident that we are here. We have a divine appointment with you. And so I'm asking that the Spirit would move in us today, touching each heart. Let the people see you and not me. Help me to get out of the way. Let the words be yours and not mine. We love you and thank you. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. If you're visiting with us, we do this every Sunday because we are a Bible teaching, Bible preaching church. We preach straight from God's word, and we say, are you ready to go into battle? Hold that sword up in the air, and we say these words, man cannot live by bread alone. Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Do you guys believe that? I mean, really, do you believe it? Because it's one thing to say, yes, we do, and then it's another thing to say, yeah, oh yeah, I really do. Today, the title of the sermon today is Father, Forgive Them. And hopefully you got an outline, and on the outline you'll see blanks and you'll see scripture. Remember the words that are underlined are the verses underlined, will are just for reference only. I will mention them, but I will not be reading them. Valerie might throw them up on the screen for us, but I will not actually be taking the time to go to that in Scripture. It's there so you can go back and look at it and know that I'm not just putting something up on the screen. Easter's a time of celebration. All right? Unfortunately, not everybody in the world is celebrating today. I hate to say it, but not all Christians are celebrating. It's just become another day. But for me as a Christian, I celebrate Christmas because we have Emmanuel, God with us. And I'm celebrating that Jesus Christ left his heavenly throne to be born in a manger. But I also celebrate Easter because Easter's when my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ stepped out of the tomb so that we can have eternity with him, where we can have victory over death and victory over sins. And I celebrate this. So take your Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 23. Today we're going to look at several places within the Bible. We're flipping back and forth, so keep those fingers licked. Luke chapter 23. And I always like to pause long enough to let our students up here in the first four or five rows find it, the scripture in their Bible. Luke chapter 23, verses 33 and 34. Remember, the title of today's sermon is found in this section of Scripture. The Bible reads this way. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him and criminals, one on the right, one on the other on the left. But Jesus was saying, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. I've heard a lot of people criticize Christians saying these words. Practice what you preach. Practice what you preach. You say you're a Christian and you want to pull that holier than thou card. Well, practice what you preach. Well, guess what? Jesus never had that said to him. Jesus never had that said to him. Remember when the disciples were asking Jesus, they were asking Jesus, hey, teach us how to pray. How should we pray? And he teaching them what we call today the Lord's Prayer. And he says, forgive us our trespasses. And he's asking, he's talking to God. He says, forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. So Jesus himself was actually practicing the Lord's Prayer. The first one on your outline is Jesus practiced the Lord's Prayer when he asked God to forgive those who were driving the nails in his hands and his feet. He asked God to forgive them, for they didn't know what they were doing. We'll talk about that more in a minute. When I was preparing this sermon, I was like, put myself in those places. How can I ask God to forgive someone that's driving the nails in my hands and feet, that have already beaten me? How can I ask God to forgive me for that? Well, first of all, it starts by us forgiving them. And so when Jesus asked God the Father to forgive those who were crucifying him, he himself had already forgiven them. The next one on your outline, a person cannot ask God to forgive another person if they haven't forgiven him. Remember in the Beatitudes, Jesus was preaching and he said in Luke 6, 27 and 28 that we are to pray for those who mistreat us, those who are our enemies. We're supposed to pray for our enemies. Pastor, are you nuts? They're my enemy. Why would I pray for them? Because as Christians, we are to be different than the rest of the world. We are to love our enemies and pray for them. And Jesus is setting the example. For those of you who know me, know that I'm pretty competitive. It took years for me to let one of my children win at a game. I figured they learn by the agony of defeat to get better. I'll be honest with you. I'm a pastor and I love the Lord with all my heart. I don't know exactly what I would be doing, but I kind of imagine if someone was driving a nail in my hands and my feet, the last thing I would be thinking was, God, please forgive them. Can you imagine that? Just think about at a sporting event. You ever get in an argument at a sporting event? I know some of you. Confession's good for the soul, but bad for the reputation, right? How about school, students? How about school? How about at work? You got that person over there rubbing up against the boss trying to get the raise, the new position. How about this one? Praying for the people that hurt you in church. In church. I'm going to pick on Bob Banks. He sent me a message. He said, hey, thought you were snubbing me the other day. You looked right at me and walked right past me. What's up? Yeah, I'm sorry. I wear bifocals. If I'm not looking right at you, I'm probably not seeing you. And if I am looking at you, there's a chance I'm looking past you to the person. You know, when you wave at a person and there's someone in between you and you go, I don't really know him, but I'll wave back. And then really the person behind them is going, hey, and you go, oh. Yeah. It's amazing how people can get hurt. The thing is, we get angry, we want to attack, we want to jump back. But not Jesus. He said, Father, forgive them. And Jesus is still saying, Father, forgive them. Forgive. He's still saying, forgive today. He's still saying, forgive today. He wants you to be forgiven for your sins. And he's saying that day in and day out. You see, the religious people, they actually crucified Jesus for saying that your sins were forgiven. Because they thought that was blasphemous to God, because only God can forgive sins. They didn't realize that we have God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. God the Son, Jesus Christ, here on the planet, walking among them, had the authority as God the Son to say, your sins are forgiven. Let's look what I mean. Go to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. You want to figure out what kind of church you need to be. You need to be an Acts chapter 2 type of church. Acts chapter 2, verse 38 through 42. Peter's preaching. You know, the one that denied Jesus three times, that let Jesus down not once, not twice, but three times. Now he's preaching. So don't let anyone tell you that God can't use you. You've let God down. You're a failure. You might have failed, but that doesn't make you a failure. Look what it says here in Acts chapter 2, verse 38 through 42. Peter said to them, repent, and each of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. And with many other words, he solemnly testified and kept on exhorting them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. So then those who had received his word were baptized, and that day there were added about 3,000 souls. They were continually devoting themselves to the apostles' teaching, the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Could you imagine the day of Pentecost when 3,000 souls were saved? And it's the same sermon today. Repent. Repent of your sins. Come to forgiveness of your sins. Jesus Christ died on the cross. The one that they crucified died for you and for your sins. It's thought that some of the very people that were crucifying Jesus, that he might have been saying, Father, forgive them. It was thought that some of those people were there. It's very well that some of those people that were there that were crucifying Jesus heard the sermon, Father, forgive them, and had trusted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Those people who were added to that day accepted Jesus' words for forgiveness. The next one on your outline, giving or receiving forgiveness can be very hard for people. Giving or receiving forgiveness can be very hard for people. I cannot tell you the number of times as a pastor I've had someone say, but you don't know what I've done. I don't know and I don't care. God knows. Hey, that's in your past. And I'm not going to judge you on your past. Don't judge me on my past. I don't live there anymore. God has forgiven me for my sins. He's washed those clear. He'll do the same for you. I just can't accept it. You know what? The hardest person to forgive sometimes is you. Sometimes the hardest person to forgive is the person you're looking at in the mirror. Because I don't think I deserve it. I don't think I'm good enough for it. I got news for you. Come real close. You're not. You're not good enough for Jesus' forgiveness, but he loves you anyway. He says, in spite of your shortfalls, I love you. I love you. I love you. When you think about the people there that was crucifying him, and he said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing. Think about the people that were mocking Jesus at the time. And he's saying, Father, forgive them. What about the soldiers that were driving the nails into his hands and his feet? What'd he say? Father, forgive them. What about those individuals that were whipping him and beating him? Father, forgive them. What about the very religious people? Father, forgive them. The very religious leaders that had him crucified, he had to say, Father, forgive them. Because he died for them as much as he did for you and me. You know, when we come into this world, we don't have to be taught how to lie. It just comes natural. Or how to cheat. You can ask our directors in the youth department. You have a game, and I guarantee you the youth group, the church people, will figure out a way to cheat. I've been there. Listen to me. Yeah, you got to watch them like a hawk. Yeah, because it comes natural. You don't have to teach them how to covet. Boy, I'd like to have that. I guarantee you there's a child in the nursery right now stealing an object from some other child. No parent in here is going to take, I taught him how to do that. That's my child. Look at him stealing real good. You don't teach him that. This comes natural. Comes natural because we don't know what we're doing. What we're doing goes against God's will for our lives, for those who are Christians. The next one on your outline. We are an enemy to the cross because we do not know what we're doing, just like those who Jesus said to forgive. You're an enemy to the cross, and you didn't even know it. You didn't know that all fall short of the glory of God until you hear what you're doing is wrong. What you're doing goes against God's word. Yes, we're born with a conscience, but each person's conscience is different. The Holy Spirit's the same in everyone. When sin entered mankind at the Garden of Eden, but in Adam and Eve, every person that's born after that is born a sinner. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. We've fallen short of what God wants for us. Turn your Bibles over to John chapter 2. John chapter 2. John chapter 2, verses 18 through 22. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. John chapter 2, verse 18 through 22. Look what it says here. The Jews then said to him, what sign do you show us as your authority for doing these things? Jesus answered them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. The Jews then said, it took 46 years to build this temple and you'll raise it up in 3 days. But he was speaking of the temple of his body. So when he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he said this, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had spoken. Jesus, can you just imagine just being around him and having just his knowledge falling out? And he says, destroy this temple, and in 3 days it's going to rise up again. You always had those people, well, it took 46 years to build it. You're going to do it in 3 days? He's talking about himself. We know the Easter story, that Jesus Christ was crucified on a cross. He's buried in that grave, a borrowed grave. And then 3 days later, he arose. And that's what he was talking about. He was saying, look, in 3 days, I'm going to rise again. You're going to kill this temple? I'm coming back. I'm coming back. Today, I'm going to teach you something. I'm going to learn you something. Okay? I'm going to learn you something. Passover week. This is Passover week. It's finishing today. Passover week. The Passover week was different from the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement is somewhere around September, October. So the Day of Atonement was a day in Old Testament times when the high priest and the priest had various duties that they'd have to do. So on the Day of Atonement, everyone who was a Jew would bring a lamb to the synagogue, to the temple, and to sacrifice the lamb. Now imagine all those lambs being sacrificed. If you didn't have enough money, you could go together with another family, you could come together and bring that lamb. But they'd start sacrificing in the temple, and the blood would just, for days, sometimes it took as many as 3 days to sacrifice all the lambs for the Day of Atonement for all the families, round the clock. And they said the blood would run down out of the temple steps to the Kidron Valley. The high priest had a job that was done one day a year. He would go behind the veil into what's called the Holy of Holies. And he had a ritual that he had to do, and he'd have to sprinkle some blood on him and on the Ark of the Covenant and sprinkle on the mercy seat and so many things that he was doing. And all, if you study the Ark of the Covenant and behind the curtain of the Holy of Holies, all it was pointing to was Jesus Christ at the cross. And so the mercy and the blood and so the high priest would go behind the veil on the Day of Atonement. Not to be confused with the Passover. The Passover, if you watched the Ten Commandments yesterday, was on. If you watched the Ten Commandments, the Passover was when the Hebrew children was in Egypt, and the plague that they were going to send in was the death angel. And the Hebrew children knew that they had to put blood over the doorposts or on the sides so that the death angel would pass by that house. And God, in his infinite wisdom, at Calvary, is combining Passover and the Day of Atonement together. You see, it took the blood of Jesus Christ being shed so that the death angel would pass over those, all those who trust Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. You can have eternal life. The same way it was in Egypt, the death angel would come by. If they saw the blood over top of the doorpost and on the sidepost of the door, he would pass by. They'd live. Well, guess what? Through Jesus Christ's blood, you're going to live. The Day of Atonement paid for the sins of the people, but guess what? It just covered it up. It just covered it up. Unlike Jesus Christ, whose blood takes away the sins of the world, John the Baptist said it himself in John 1:29. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Takes them away. They're gone. Don't let Satan bring it back up to you. It's covered. It's gone. It is absolutely gone forever. Turn to Matthew chapter 27. I always say there's no better commentary on the Bible than the Bible itself. Matthew chapter 27, verse 50 and 51. I want you to see something here. Matthew chapter 27, verse 50 and 51. And Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. And behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And the earth shook and the rocks were split. You know what veil he's talking about? That's the veil that separated the Holy of Holies from the holy place. The Holy of Holies on the Day of Atonement. Remember I told you these are combining God in his infinite wisdom, combining the Day of Atonement with the Passover. The veil that separated man from the very presence of God on the Ark of the Covenant has been torn from top to bottom, and only God could tear that apart so that man doesn't need a priest anymore. He can go directly to God through his son, Jesus Christ. That's amazing that you and I, we have access to God the Father through Jesus the Son. That veil's not there anymore. It's gone. And at any time in my life, I can stop and pray. I can stop and pray because Jesus Christ gave me that ability. God had that plan from the very beginning. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Turn to Romans chapter 6. This ought to be a verse you have memorized. Romans chapter 6, verse 23. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. Think of the death angel. Death. The wages, what we're earning with our sins is death. That death is a total separation from God for all eternity. But look what the good news comes after that. Look what it says after that. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. The free gift of God doesn't charge us anything. It cost our Savior his life. He's going to give it to you so you don't have to experience death. The same as the blood being over the doorpost, over the mantle. I praise God that he had a plan. I praise God that Jesus didn't stay in that grave. On that third day, he comes stepping out of there so that we can have that free gift of eternal life through him. Turn over 1 Corinthians, a couple pages to the right. I want you to see something. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 55 through 57. Look what it says here. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. Underline this part. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. The next one on your outline. Death is nothing to fear for those who are in Christ Jesus. I've got nothing to fear. You want to threaten me with a good time? Hey, we're going to kill you. Great. I'm going to step into the presence of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You going to threaten me with walking on the streets of gold, reuniting with all the loved ones that have went on before? You think that scares me? Yeah, I might feel a little bit of pain right here, but I am not scared of death. Jesus conquered death. I'm going to spend eternity in heaven, and I know that for sure because Jesus Christ died on that cross for my sins, and he's not in that grave. He arose so that I can have victory over death too. How about you? How about you? The moment that we breathe our last, we're stepping to eternity somewhere. It's going to be heaven or it's going to be hell. My question is, do you know him? Do you know him? Today we are celebrating Easter, the resurrection day, the day that Jesus Christ, we are celebrating that he is alive. We're celebrating that. Do you know him? I asked you, I said, man cannot live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And I said, do you believe? And you go, yeah, we believe that, Pastor. Do you really believe that? Do you believe that if you were to breathe your last right now, that you would step in the very presence of God? If not, today you can know that for sure. Today you can know that for sure. Jesus is alive. He's sitting at the right hand of God, and he's waiting for him to say, go get my children. And I think we're closer now than we've ever been. They've already started they built the altar for sacrifices. We studied that on Wednesday night. They already got the red heifers. They're breeding those. And I'm telling you, we're close. They're already cutting stones for the temple. You better get ready. You better get ready. It is coming. My question is, if Jesus would come back today, have you accepted forgiveness that he asked the Father to forgive him of? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Christ himself, John 14:6, said this. Jesus said that he's the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. You cannot buy your way in. You cannot work your way in. You'll never be good enough. Heaven is a place of 100% righteousness, holiness. There's no evil, unrighteousness. No, none of that's allowed in. And I already told you, you're born a sinner. The only way you're going to get in is through Jesus Christ's blood. Jesus is still forgiving people. And he wants to forgive you. What a better day to trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior than on Easter. Hey, when did you get saved? For me, it was January 21st, 1971. When did you get saved? Easter 2024. Today's the day of salvation, the Bible says. In a moment, we're going to give him an invitation. And I'm going to invite you to step out where you are, come down the aisle and say, hey, I want to trust Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. I want to accept his forgiveness. Don't think you're not good enough. Don't think you're too bad. Listen, if he forgave the criminal on the cross beside him, he can forgive you. Just come forward and say, hey, I want to trust Jesus. I'm not asking you to be a Bible scholar. I'm still learning things. I'm not asking you to join the church. I'm asking you to join the church body, the body of Christ, by trusting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you come forward and say, hey, I want to trust Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, we'll have someone walk you to another room, show you what God's word says, let you make the decision. Maybe you are looking for a church home and you'd like to be a part of this church. We'd love to have you. I mean, God's doing fantastic things here. It's just amazing what all he's doing. It's shocking. I can't explain it. People say, what's going on at Real Joy? God. What? Yeah, in spite of me, God. Amen. You'd like to be a member of this church? Just come forward and say, hey, I'd like to be a member of this church. Have someone walk you to another room, ask some questions, fill out some paperwork with you, have prayer with you. Maybe you want to come to the altar and pray and say, you know what, God? I need forgiveness. And I'm turning it over to you. Father, forgive me because I know not what I'm doing. Let's pray. Father God, I come to you right now to thank you so much for your word and how it speaks to us. And God, as we've looked at your word today, not as a normal Easter sermon, but God, one that shows that Jesus loves us and still saying, forgive them, forgive them. And God, we know that your forgiveness is always there. So I'm asking you would just speak to our hearts, speak to our minds today. Father God, if there's one here today that doesn't know Jesus Christ, you'll give them that courage to step out and say, yeah, I want to trust him today. Father God, for those who are looking for a church home, I pray that you give them the courage to step out and say, hey, I want to join this church today. I want to start serving the Lord right here. Those come to the altar and pray, Father, whatever decision it might be, Father, let that decision be made to bring glory and honor to you and to you alone. We ask us in Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with us as we sing this hymn invitation?